Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Few Against Many by Ryk Brown, narrated by Jeffrey Kafer. Chapter 1. Nathan had spent several hours at Jessica's side, doing his best to assess the condition of both her long and short-term memories. It would take extensive testing to determine the level of success of her resurrection in the biosynth pod, but as far as Nathan was concerned, it had been a complete success. "Captain," Aiden called from down the corridor. Nathan slowed his pace, allowing Aiden to catch up to him. "You've got to start calling me Nathan, Aiden," Nathan urged. "It'll be easier once we get my ship back in service," Aiden replied. "How's Jessica?"
"Amazingly well," Nathan said. "It's like nothing ever happened."
"That's miraculous," Aiden admitted.
"I mean, she looked. Please don't remind me," Nathan said as they entered the Atlantis's briefing room. General Tellis and Abby were already seated at the conference table. Cameron, Robert, and Jacome were each on separate view screens.
"Sorry I was delayed," Nathan apologized as he and Aiden took their seats. "I was helping them assess Jessica's memories."
"How is she?" Robert asked.
"Like nothing ever happened," Nathan replied. "She even remembers taking the hits. Luckily, everything after that gets progressively less clear. And she has no memory at all of dying. In fact, she doesn't even remember being carried out to the Saiki for evac. Dr. Barra thinks it's due to the chemical changes that took place in the brain due to severe trauma. Regardless, she is healthy as can be."
"But in a biosynth body for which there is no long-term research," Cameron pointed out.
"Better than losing her," Nathan said. "When will she return to duty?" Robert asked. "She's a terrible patient, you know."
"She could return now, to be honest, but they want to run more tests and keep an eye on her for a day or two," Nathan explained.
"We would also like to put her through some Gadajak combat trials to make sure she hasn't lost any of her physical coordination or combat skills," the general added.
"You can call her whenever you like," Nathan told Robert.
"Thank you, I will."
"What comes next?" Jacome asked.
"We need to get the battle platforms out of the Persa system and hide them somewhere," General Tellis stated.
"We need to refit them with super jump drives," Nathan insisted.
"I've already run that scenario past our AI," the general said. "It's a bit more complicated than you might think."
"How so?" Robert asked.
"Well, there are two approaches," Abby began. "Scale up the system proportionally or use multiple independent systems working in unison."
"What are the pros and cons of each?" Cameron wondered.
"Scaling up would result in a less complex system to operate, but we'd basically be creating a prototype," Abby explained. "The initial simulations are promising, but there are always engineering issues that cannot be accounted for in simulations. And since we don't have anything remotely as large as a battle platform to test it on, we'd be risking one of them just to test the prototype."
"Doesn't the same problem apply if we use multiple independent systems?" Aiden asked.
"We already have extensive experience in jumping multiple ships under the control of a single jump controller," Abby replied.
"We do it with the dragons all the time," Nathan said.
"It is slightly different in the case of using them to jump an entire ship," Abby pointed out. "Even a fraction of a delay in jump timings, and the platform could arrive in separate pieces only a few inches apart."
"But you can prevent that, right?" Aiden asked.
"If you have a known signal travel time, you can work that into the equation to make sure every unit jumps simultaneously," Robert surmised.
"The problem is we have no idea of the condition of their legacy jump drive distribution and control network, and it would take weeks of testing to determine," Abby said. "A better solution would be to connect a dedicated AICC node to every jump subnet."
"Why not just use wireless?" Nathan wondered.
"A battle platform is 20 kilometers in diameter, Captain," Abby reminded him. "Wireless would have a delay of a few milliseconds. We could compensate for that, but wireless is also subject to interference and signal degradation. AICC nodes don't have any of those problems. Better yet, they have no signal delay."
"But we've never used AICC nodes for this purpose," Cameron said. No, but AICC nodes have been used for critical data systems spanning light years for centuries. They are proven technology, far more so than the super jump drive, Abby pointed out.
Which method would be quicker? Nathan asked.
We have been producing super jump drive components for the last 10 days now, the general said, for the Expedition-class ships and the Akuna Dera. At the moment, we have 6 completed systems.
We were about to begin installing them, Cameron said, first in the Akuna Dera, then in the rest of us.
How many do we need? Nathan asked Abby.
57, Abby replied, for one platform, and that's without a redundant system.
We can jump them without a redundant system, Aiden said.
Yes, but if something goes wrong, they could end up who knows where, Abby pointed out. If they accidentally came out in between galaxies, their legacy drive would take a lifetime to get them home. Maybe more.
Nathan sighed. Okay, so we need 228 complete systems. How long can that take?
It took us 10 days to make 6, General Tellus stated.
So more than a year, Aiden surmised.
How the hell are we going to hold on to them for a year? The Korsan will be sending every ship they have to find and recapture them.
We use their legacy jump drives, Nathan said. We cover their jump trail the same way we did for our legacy systems, using a star to obscure our jump signature and heading.
It will have to be a really big star, Cameron pointed out. 20 kilometers across, remember?
Taking a battle platform close in to a very large star will be risky, Robert warned.
Especially if they are underpowered, Cameron added.
I'll get our AI on the problem, General Tellus said. We will need detailed specifications on both platforms, though. Not just book specs, either. Current conditions as well.
Nathan sighed again. We need the cooperation of their crews, especially their captains.
If we task half of our fabricators with making additional fabricators, we may be able to speed things up a bit, Cameron suggested.
I will ask our AI to find the closest, most appropriate star to hide the platform's jump trails, and then have it factor in the fabricator build time along with the transit time to the cover stars, General Tellus said. It should be able to give us the most advantageous fabrication schedule.
Good idea, Nathan agreed.
How soon can you have that?
Atlantis, the general called.
The nearest, most appropriate cover star is Bella 1247, a blue giant 484 light-years from the Persis system. The Atlantis AI replied, based on the battle platform's current power generation capabilities and the condition of their jump drives, that journey would take approximately 15.35 standard days. As to the fabricator production schedule, devoting all the fabricators to the production of creating new fabricators will reduce the total production time to 8 months and 5 days. Assuming an installation time of 2 months, that brings the project to completion in approximately 10 months.
Thank you, Atlantis.
If we can put the crews from the platforms to work, we can probably cut the installation time in half, Abby suggested.
Let's hope those platforms have a few fabricators of their own, Aiden added.
So I guess I should go speak to their captains, Nathan decided.
How do you plan on getting their cooperation? Cameron wondered.
I don't know, Nathan admitted. Appeal to their sense of honor? Promise them a life that doesn't involve killing or being killed?
I'm pretty sure you're going to have to offer them credits, Aiden warned.
I figured I'd offer them really long lives through cloning or maybe even using the biosynth pod, Nathan admitted.
Why not offer both? Jacome suggested.
You're talking about 700 people, Jacome, Nathan pointed out, and that's minimal staff.
I'm not suggesting we give them a livable wage, Jacome explained. Offer them a small stipend, something they can use during shore leave or send home to their families or whatever. They're getting food, shelter, medical care, training, and work experience, so they don't need much in the way of regular compensation. Instead, promise them a weekly stipend and an end-of-contract bonus large enough for them to start a new life wherever they want, doing whatever they want.
How are we going to afford that? Nathan asked.
If I invest a modest amount per person, that investment will double within 5 years, even more, over a decade, Jacome explained. We can even offer a vesting schedule.
Lieutenant Commander Siddons says that most of the crew they have interviewed thus far have been technicians, not pirates. They may be more inclined to accept our offer, the general said. Let's hope, Nathan agreed. Nathan entered the compartment on the Atlantis, where the captains of the two battle platforms were being detained. Two gardes Jacques had been guarding the door outside, and two more stood silently in the room with the two commanders. I'm Nathan Scott, captain of the Free Fleet Ship Aurora, he said as he took a seat at the head of the table.
Jakan Fratar, commander of the Cam Fui, Jakan replied.
Samel Zani, commander of the Diol, the woman snapped. On what authority have you taken control of our vessels?
None, Nathan replied. On what authority did you attack Persa?
The Khorasan Empire,
Samel stated confidently.
They're an empire now,
Nathan said, trying not to laugh but allowing his amusement to be noticed by his guests.
Well then, it appears that the Khorasan Empire has declared war on Persa, which would make the two of you prisoners of war. Perhaps I should turn you over to the Persians for judgment.
No one judges the Khorasan,
Commander Zani boasted. Cut the crap, lady, Nathan snapped. I don't have time for this BS.
You spoke of an offer before,
Jakan said, attempting to defuse the situation being created by the Diol's commander.
The Khorasan do not make deals. You attacked us, Captain.
Because you were attacking an innocent, unarmed world, Nathan replied.
The Persians are not innocent,
Samel insisted. They refuse to comply with Khorasan directives.
Jesus, lady, if you don't shut up and listen, I'm going to have you gagged, Nathan warned.
Please, Captain, the deal, Jakan urged.
Nathan leaned back in his chair, glaring at Commander Zani.
What did you do before you joined the Khorasan? Nathan asked Jakan.
I was an administrator of an industrial fabrication facility on Beer Bomb, Jakan answered.
That's an alliance world. Sounds like a good job. Why'd you join the Khorasan?
I didn't exactly join, Jakan admitted. I was offered a substantial increase in compensation to oversee the logistics of repairing and eventually refitting both platforms.
Your previous job seems far more secure than working for a criminal syndicate, Nathan commented.
The increased pay would have made my retirement much more comfortable.
And you? Nathan asked Samel.
I don't see what this has to do with humor me, Nathan pleaded.
Samel sighed, displaying her irritation for all to see.
I was the commanding officer of a Khorasan cruiser.
How long have you been in command of the Diol?
I was recently transferred.
How recently?
10 days ago.
And before you commanded a cruiser? Nathan asked.
I was the XO.
And before that?
Tactical officer.
Let's try this. How long have you worked for the Khorasan? Nathan asked.
20 years, give or take.
And before that?
Samel leaned forward, looking Nathan in the eyes.
I was a whore.
How the hell did you end up a Khorasan officer? Nathan wondered.
I killed a Khorasan sergeant when he tried to rape me, Samel explained. His CO was impressed and made me his personal concubine. I killed him as well. His CO made me a junior officer and put me in security.
Nathan paused for a moment. We intend to convert the battle platforms into mobile space stations.
Why?
Jakan wondered. To support Free Fleet operations and humanity.
You'll never get the chance, Samel seethed.
You're a very angry person, aren't you? Nathan said.
Samel only glared at him.
Seeing as how you're such a loyal officer of the Khorasan, perhaps you'd like us to return you to them.
Samel's glare softened.
That's what I thought, Nathan said. You have two options. We can release you and provide transportation to a world of your choosing, or you can work for us.
We'll be hunted down and executed, Samel stated.
Then working for us would probably be your best bet, Nathan told her.
The Khorasan plan to eliminate you and your free fleet, Samel said. I don't see working for you as a safer option.
If you return to the Khorasan, they'll execute you for failing to carry out your orders, Nathan pointed out.
With us, you at least have a chance. The Khorsan will find you, Jakan warned. They always do. The Khorsan won't be able to reach us, Nathan explained. How do you figure? Jakan wondered. Let's just say our jump range far exceeds theirs, Nathan replied. Jakan looked at him with furrowed brow. How far are we talking? That's classified, but believe me, the Khorsan would not be able to reach us.
And we're supposed to believe that? Samael said.
If you agree to join our cause, you'll see for yourself.
And what exactly is your cause? Samael wondered.
To promote liberty, truth, peace, and prosperity for all of humanity, Nathan replied. Very noble, Jakan admitted.
Idealistic insanity, Samael commented.
Perhaps, Nathan admitted, but we like it.
The Khorsan will never allow it, Samael insisted.
They won't have much say in the matter, Nathan stated.
They are far more powerful than you can imagine.
I'll take that as a no, Nathan said.
I did not say that, Samael corrected.
Then there is a chink in that Khorsan armor of yours.
As you explained, Captain, it may be the safest of our two options.
I'm going to be up front with you, Commander, Nathan said. I'm not inclined to trust you based on your remarks thus far.
Understandable.
If you try to cross us, you'll be handed over to the Khorsan.
This is what you call a deal? Samael asked.
This is what I call an option, Nathan explained. Do with it what you will. What kind of compensation are we talking about? Jakan wondered.
Regular compensation will be minimal, Nathan explained.
However, an investment will be made in each of your names, and once the platforms have been fully refitted for their new role, all proceeds from those investments will be yours. At that point, you can either continue working for the Free Fleet, or you can use those proceeds to retire comfortably on the world of your choice.
Where the Khorsan will find us and kill us, Samael said.
We can give you an entirely new body, Nathan explained, one that has a completely different appearance. You could walk right under their noses and they'd never recognize you.
There is still the risk of being killed when they find the platforms, Samael stated.
Quite a bit of risk for minimal compensation. We can guarantee your resurrection, Nathan assured her.
Cloning?
Something like that. And the same deal would be offered to both our crews, Jakan asked. Assuming they are interested, Nathan confirmed.
There is one problem, Samael warned.
The Khorsan are already on their way.
We plan on getting the platforms out of here as soon as possible, Nathan assured them.
You don't understand, Samael replied. By now the Khorsan have realized we were unsuccessful. Once they realize that you have captured their precious battle platforms, they will issue a galactic kill order. Every clan, every merc, every privateer will be hunting you and those platforms, not to mention your ship. And when they catch up to you, it will be gruesome. They will carve up every person under your command and make you watch. Then they'll torture you to death, resurrect you, and do it again. Then they'll go after your family, friends, and acquaintances. Hell, they'll even murder any whore who so much as smiles at you.
All that, Nathan said. It's how they maintain power, she explained.
Then I suppose the only thing we can do is follow our principles and hope for the best.
The only way you can stop them is to kill them.
All those clans? That's a lot of people to kill, Nathan said.
You don't need to kill all of them, Samael explained. You only need to kill the ones at the top.
Kill them and there's no one left to pay the bounty on your heads. The clans will go back to the way it was before the Khorsan came along, raping and pillaging the Badlands and fighting each other. More innocent people will die without the Khorsan than with them.
We can handle the Khorsan and the clans, Nathan stated confidently.
With two ships, I don't think so.
We've taken down bigger with far less, Nathan told her.
As long as you know what we're up against.
We? Nathan wondered. Does that mean you accept our offer?
I don't see that I have much choice, Samael admitted.
Nathan looked at Jakan.
I accept as well, Jakan stated.
I'll have our attorney draw up contracts for you and your officers. I'll leave it to the two of you to make the offer to your senior staff.
As for the rest of your crews, we'll speak with them after you've spoken with your officers.
Understood, Jakan acknowledged. Samael nodded the same, albeit far less enthusiastically.
Something you should know, Nathan said. We will be closely monitoring every one of you. Trust must be earned.
From you as well, Samael stated.
Fair enough, Nathan agreed. If I may ask a couple questions?
Jakan and Samael both nodded.
What is your maximum jump range and what is your recharge time?
I get a good feeling about Jakan, Nathan told General Tellus.
And the other one?
She's a tough read, Nathan admitted as he took a seat on the couch in the general's ready room. She's either a true believer in the Empire or she just fell into the life and was making the best of a bad situation.
Can they be trusted?
Jakan only took the position to set himself up for retirement. He used to be the administrator of a fabrication plant. No military or flight training whatsoever. He's a straight logistics and management type, Nathan explained. He doesn't seem to have any loyalty to the Corson. Samael, on the other hand, is far more ruthless. She's killed before, and I doubt she would have a problem killing again as long as it suits her needs. I would keep a close eye on her.
Perhaps we should put her off someplace, the general suggested.
That may be best, but I'd like to see how it goes. We can dump her any time. I got the impression that Jakan was running both platforms prior to Samael's arrival, and that the Corson transferred her there when they decided to put the platforms into action. She didn't seem too happy about it. All 15 years of her time in the Corson were spent on the same cruiser, from concubine to captain.
How did she manage that ascension? The general wondered.
Hard work and assassination.
A close eye indeed.
The platforms have a max jump range of 100 light years, but they've been limiting their jumps to 20 for safety reasons. With their current power generation capacity, it takes them about 6 hours to recharge. Theoretically, they can jump now, but I'd suggest we wait for a final damage report before getting underway. We pounded them pretty good.
We've already started making offers to some of their technical specialists, General Tellus said. We're giving them comm sets. I've got my people setting up portable comms gear since the original internal comm system is unreliable. Brianna, Laza, and Anori are working on locking down all appropriate access permissions on critical functions and areas.
You think there are Corson loyalists among the technicians?
They'd be foolish not to have them, the general said.
It was foolhardy to send the platforms into battle in their current condition and with commanders who had no clue how to use them.
It was, the general agreed. But it would also be foolhardy for us to underestimate them, considering the value of these assets to us.
Agreed. Has your AI spit up that fabrication schedule?
Fabrication schedule, installations, navigation routes, and jump schedules. He's even working on evaluations of the platform's current state and how to best go about refitting them. We just need more information from you about how you see us using them.
It's not up to me, Nathan insisted. It's up to all the captains.
Like it or not, Nathan, you are the fleet's de facto leader. Each captain, myself included, looks to you for inspiration.
Nathan took a deep breath, letting it out slowly. He had no desire to lead the free fleet, but he realized the general was right. It was Nathan's idea, and although the other captains felt as he did, the round table hadn't yet reached the point where everyone spoke freely. He was still leading those meetings.
The only thing I know for sure is that they need to be disarmed. No one should have weapons that powerful. Fully powered, those platforms could turn an entire planet into rubble in less than an hour. That's too much destructive power for anyone to have, even us.
I assume we'll be keeping their defenses intact?
Of course, get rid of their missile launchers and main guns, but keep all point defenses and give them better shields.
Their shields are more than adequate, especially if we give them super jump drives, the general said. They only need to fend off an attack long enough to jump away. Besides, if we remove all their offensive weapons and turn them into wandering space stations, there will be little reason to attack them.
Let's hope so, Nathan agreed. How long until we can jump them to Libertara?
That's one of the things I wanted to speak with you about, the general said.
Our AI offered an alternate plan. Based on the jump logs of both platforms, he agreed with that same 20-light-year jump pattern you spoke of. At that rate, it would take just under a year for the platforms to reach Libertara using their legacy jump systems. But to what end? It will take years to refit them, right? More like decades. Having them parked in orbit above Libertara will make them easier to overhaul, Nathan stated. That's legacy thinking, the general said. Based on the Free Fleet's mission, our AI recommends that we task a percentage of our fabricators to making more fabricators but continue with our original fabrication schedules. How is that better? Those additional fabricators can be given to the battle platforms. We can then feed them raw materials and consumables. Jacome has agreed to have the Norleander fitted with super jump drive so that it can move goods from Libertara to the battle platforms. It can do so as easily as if the platforms were orbiting Libertara. So you don't think we should try to outfit them with super jump drives? Until they are in better condition, they are more of a liability than an asset. But we do need to move them out of reach as soon as possible. Agreed, but we don't need to fit them with super jump drives to do so. Besides, our strategic position is better if we have more ships in service. You're talking about the Expedition-class ships, Nathan surmised. Precisely. We can have the Celestia fully operational in 6 months. The Navarro 6 months after that. The Free Fleet can have 4 Expedition-class ships out doing good in under 2 years, complete with full complements of dragons, drones, and missiles. That would give us a huge advantage against the Coruscant. We're not looking to fight a war, Nathan insisted. Of course not, the general agreed. But the Coruscant may be hell-bent on fighting one with us. We need to be ready to respond, and we can get the rest of the Expedition-class ships combat-ready far faster than the battle platforms. We still need to strip off their guns, Nathan insisted. The Coruscant will try to find them and recapture them. If that happens, we sure as hell don't want them to still be armed. Then we are in agreement. We are, Nathan replied, sighing. Something wrong? How many people do we have to kill in order to get people to stop killing? Humans kill, the general stated. There's nothing we can do to change that other than remove the need to kill. That's why the Gadajok were created. We were to be the protectors of freedom and liberty, not just for the Takarans, but for all worlds. Unfortunately, we were hijacked by Caius and programmed to become ruthless killers loyal to one man. Until you came along and changed all of that. I believe we have the chance of doing the same. By killing the Coruscant, Nathan surmised. By defeating the Coruscant, the general corrected. Is there a difference? That is up to the Coruscant. Maybe we should speak directly to them, Nathan suggested. Offer them a chance to avoid further conflict. You can try, the general said, but I am confident it will be to no avail. You're probably right, but I feel I have to try. As you wish.
Nathan finally retired to his quarters around 2300 hours. He was so exhausted that he simply went to his couch and plopped down, lying back to rest a bit before heading for the shower. Between the Coruscant battle group, the bombardment of Persa, the capture of 2 battle platforms and Jessica's death and subsequent resurrection, it had been an 18-hour emotional roller coaster ride. Before he knew it, his eyes were closed and his mouth was hanging open, already drifting off. Captain, Aurora called in a soft voice. When he didn't respond, she called more loudly. Captain? Nathan woke with a start.
Yes?
I apologize for waking you, but you have an incoming VidCom call from Captain Taylor. Nathan sat up, rubbing his eyes. A quick glance at the clock on the wall showed it was already 1 a.m.
Put her up.
The view screen on the wall lit up and Cameron appeared, sitting at her ready room desk on the Celestia.
Were you sleeping? Cameron asked. Just taking a little nap.
Sorry.
It's okay, what's up?
Tella said you agreed with the idea of not upgrading the jump drives on the battle platforms yet.
Makes sense.
He also thinks that we're looking at a full-scale war with the Coruscant.
Probably.
After a short pause, he added,
And?
And what?
You're going to tell me I'm wasting my time trying to negotiate with a Corson?
Something like that. I wasn't planning on negotiating with them.
Then what were you planning to say?
I figured I'd suggest that they work out a different business model, one that doesn't involve killing and terrorizing people who don't want to do business with them.
And when they refuse?
I'll warn them of the consequences.
Again, I have to ask why.
So I can sleep at night, Cam.
If you're going to do that, then you're going to have to warn every pirate clan in the galaxy. And when you do that, you're going to be alerting the Alliance, who depend on the threat of piracy to dissuade their citizens from leaving their sphere of influence. In essence, you'd be inviting a war with the Alliance as well.
That's up to them, Nathan insisted, just as it is up to the Corson.
Well, you might want to wait a while, Cameron suggested. At least until after you get the battle platforms through their cover jump.
Yep, you're probably right about that, Nathan agreed. Have you made their first jump yet?
They're fully charged, but Vlad wants to perform a full diagnostic to check for battle damage.
How long is that going to take? Cameron wondered.
A few days at least.
Then maybe you should get their shields repaired first.
Yep, working on that. We've got all our fabricators making replacement emitters. Laza was able to pull the schematics for them from the platform's engineering database.
How much of the crew is staying on?
So far, most of them want to join us, not because they believe in what we're doing, but because they're afraid of what the Corson will do to them if they return without the platforms. There's another problem, however. Some of them have families that they're worried about. We may have to extract them.
How are you planning on doing that?
I have no idea. Maybe they got a Jacques.
Well, we're sending you two super jump drive packages for the Seiki and the Mirai, so that will probably help,
Cameron told him. The rest we're putting into our shuttles so that we can reach you quickly when necessary.
What about the Akuna?
She's sort of a special case, but we'll start fabrication for her conversion in another week or so.
I'm sure the Ferrurias won't mind waiting, especially Josie.
I'm sure. I wanted to run a couple of things past you.
Is it urgent? It's 1 a.m. here.
Considering the travel time, yes. Dominic wants to join you and help Vlad with the battle platforms.
Don't you need him there?
Not for at least a few weeks, Cameron stated.
Well, no reason to put him on a slow shuttle. We can jump over and pick up him and the super jump drive packages for our shuttles. To be honest, I wouldn't mind putting my feet on friendly soil. It's been a while.
I'll let him know, Cameron replied.
What was the other thing? Nathan asked.
It's about Robert, Cameron said.
Nothing is wrong with him, I hope.
No, nothing is wrong. In fact, I don't think I've ever seen him happier. He's really making progress on his ranch. He should even be receiving his first shipment of breeder cows in a couple of weeks.
So what's the problem? Nathan wondered.
Well, he's been seeing a lot of Detta lately. They're kind of becoming a thing.
Who's Detta?
Detta Klim, the captain of the Honestianus.
Really?
Yes, she spends all her surface time with him on his ranch.
And you're opposed to this?
Not at all. I just don't think he's going to be interested in commanding the Scott a couple of years from now.
Did he tell you that?
Not in so many words, Cameron admitted. But whenever he talks about the future, it's all about the ranch and not about the Scott.
Huh, Nathan said. That is surprising.
Not really, Nathan. He has spent his entire adult life in space. It seems only natural that he would want to retire to the surface. And he loves his new place. Hell, he's even building guest cottages. I think we're going to need someone to take his place.
Have anyone in mind? Nathan asked.
I think we both do, Cameron said.
Loki?
Of course.
Not Jessica, Nathan wondered.
Jessica wants to be with you, and you want to be with her, Cameron insisted. Besides, do you really want to give Jess command of a heavily armed ship with unlimited jump range? I mean, I love her like a sister, but...
Yeah, that would be disastrous, Nathan agreed.
I'll talk to him in the morning.
I think you should talk to Robert first, Cameron suggested.
Just in case I'm wrong.
You wrong?
Just talk to him, Cameron insisted.
In the morning, Nathan replied. I'm wiped.
Of course, get some sleep,
Cameron said before ending the call.
Nathan pulled off his boots, then leaned back on the couch again.
Captain Loki Sheehan, he said, a smile creeping across his tired face. Nathan never made it to his bed, eventually just falling asleep on the couch. Unfortunately, it was not for long. The trim lighting in his quarters suddenly turned red and a muffled alert klaxon sounded. General quarters, general quarters, the ship's AI announced over the ship-wide intercom speakers. All hands man your battle stations. This is not a drill. Nathan woke feeling groggy, but the sudden jolt of explosions rocking his ship snapped him fully awake. He was on his feet in seconds. Having never removed his uniform, he was out the door in seconds, running for the forward elevator. Aurora, report, he called as he jogged down the corridor. Surprise attack, Aurora replied. One heavy cruiser and three gunships, all Coruscant. They preceded their arrival with jump missiles, two of which made it through our defenses and impacted our shields. I went to full combat configuration the moment the jump missiles appeared. Bridge, he instructed as he stepped inside the elevator. The door closed as the ship rocked from another explosion, causing Nathan to nearly lose his balance. What about the battle platforms? He asked. Both were alerted. Thus far, they have not been targeted. Seconds later, the doors opened, and Nathan bolted out of the elevator and headed forward. Just ahead of him were Abby and Seema, who would likely come out of the starboard elevator. Shoot to neutralize, Nathan ordered as he headed for the bridge. Nathan entered the bridge, his first instinct taking him to his command chair, but instead he stopped at the tactical station. You're in my spot, a familiar voice complained from behind him. Nathan turned around as the ship rocked again. Behind him was Jessica, standing there with her arms crossed, dressed in her usual crew t-shirt and uniform pants and boots, with her long black hair tied back in a ponytail. Are you going to stand there with your mouth open or let me take my battle station? Jessica demanded. When did you get back? Nathan asked, still shocked to see her back on the bridge. Jessica pushed him aside, immediately getting to work at the tactical station. I checked myself out. The beds in that place suck, and I was getting tired of Kavans hovering over me. The ship rocked again, this time from incoming energy weapons impacts on the Aurora's shields. Are you sure you're ready? We're under fire, Nathan, Jessica reminded him. Can we talk about this later? Atlantis is engaging the cruiser, Abby reported from the sensor station. Have the Camfui and the Deal raised their shields? Only the ones that are functioning, Abby replied. They are still wide open to attack. But the Coruscants still aren't targeting them? Negative, Jessica replied. In fact, they're attacking us using angles that don't put the platforms at risk. Then they don't know, Nathan realized. Sir, Seema called from the comm station. Laza reports that the Coruscant are hailing them. Tell her not to respond, Nathan ordered. Tell both platforms to go silent, shields and defenses only. Laza reports she can get their shields up, but she needs crew to run point defenses. Aurora, target the gunships. Let the Atlantis handle the cruiser, Nathan instructed. I've already coordinated targeting with the Atlantis, Aurora replied. We are both maneuvering to avoid fire while maximizing our strikes against the attackers. Josh is asking if you want the dragons to launch, Seema reported. Tell them to stand by, Nathan replied. I don't think this one's going the distance. You think it's a recon probe? Jessica asked as the ship rocked for more weapons fire. I think the Coruscant lost contact with their battle platforms and sent their nearest ships to see what happened, Nathan said. When they saw us, they attacked. They probably have standing orders to shoot to kill. One of the gunships has lost all shields and has a hull breach, Abby reported. The wimp has jumped away, Jessica added, laughing. Cruiser shields are weakening, Abby announced. Gunship 2 is dead in space, Jessica reported, like shooting fish in a barrel. Cruiser is turning away, Abby said. They are powering up the jump drive. The shaking from incoming fire ceased. Third gunship has jumped, Jessica reported. Cruiser is jumping as well, Abby added. What was that, like 5 minutes? Nathan wondered. 3 minutes and 57 seconds, Aurora reported. Any damage? To us, no, Aurora replied. Atlantis reports no damage either. Were they pulling their punches? Nathan asked Jessica. What is with you and all the boxing references? Jessica wondered.
They were all full power shots, best I can tell, and their missiles were standard Coruscant conventionals.
How much shield strength did we lose during that engagement?
Less than 5%, Jessica replied.
Gotta love those new shields, huh?
Stand down from general quarters and set condition 2, Nathan instructed.
Seema, get me General Tellus and pipe it into my ready room, he added as he headed for his ready room.
Jess, with me.
Captain, Tellus greeted from the view screen in Nathan's ready room as he and Jessica entered.
Lieutenant Commander.
I'm pretty sure that was just a probe, Nathan said as he went to his desk.
Why?
Why do I think that?
Why would they bother?
The general clarified. Several of their ships escaped the original engagement over Persa. They should have all the data they need about our capabilities.
Then they were only checking on the status of their battle platforms. The first battleship went down 10 hours ago. After the sound beating we gave their battle group, they'd be stupid to launch another attack without some serious firepower.
Based on the previous engagement, I have to wonder if they have that much firepower,
the general opined.
Amori told me that her assessment of their fleet strength was more of a guess based on what she'd seen, heard, or discovered via snooping, Jessica explained. She admitted that it could be 10 times that. After all, the Coruscant are spread throughout Alliance space. Even with a 1,000 light-year jump range, they'd need a lot of warships to maintain control. She said that nearly every clan underreports. And while most get away with it, the Coruscant regularly use force to make examples of the worst offenders. That's why she had a job, to negotiate settlements between clans and the Coruscant, or to solve disputes between clans without going to guns. The point is, we have no idea how many ships they have. All we know is how many ships they've been able to move into position to deal with us.
After taking their battle platforms, you can bet they're recalling everything they've got to go after us, Nathan said.
They'll keep some ships spread out evenly in order to maintain some level of control over their clans, Tellus insisted. They'd have no choice. They'd lose too much revenue if the clans realized the Coruscant enforcement forces had thinned out.
What I'm worried about is Commander Zani's use of the term empire, Nathan admitted.
She seemed quite proud of it, like it was a new development.
You believe the Coruscant are making some kind of political move? General Tellus wondered.
We know that the Alliance fleet has shrunk considerably over the last couple of centuries, Nathan said.
If the Coruscant had been building up their own fleet without the Alliance's knowledge, they could eventually overthrow the Alliance, especially if they had 2 fully functional battle platforms.
They will try again, Jessica insisted. And they'll try to retake the platforms.
We need to jump them, Nathan decided.
What about Vlad's safety checks? Jessica asked.
If we keep them in one place for too long, the Coruscant will amass a force 10 times the size of the first battle group, and they will send their best forces to board and retake them.
And if they can't? Nathan wondered.
They will destroy them, probably in the same manner we would have had we not successfully captured them. They cannot afford to let a foe possess them.
Jumping them won't solve the problem, Jessica said. At least not until we get them to that cover star and jump them.
But at least they'll have to waste time tracking them, Nathan said.
We can use that to our advantage,
General Tellus suggested.
We ambush them? Jessica surmised.
Precisely, the general confirmed.
How? Nathan wondered.
We call it thinning the herd, Jessica told him. When you're a small group being pursued by a larger force, you leave a trail for them to follow. Then you peel off a few of your own to lie in wait and pick off a handful of the enemy as they pass.
The Coruscant know the practical maximum jump range for the platforms, the general explained. Because of that, we can predict where they will arrive.
We'll have to compensate for tracking lag, Nathan said, and it will only work 1 or 2 times. Eventually, they'll wise up and send in fighters or a gunship and hold off the main force until they're certain it's not another ambush.
At which point we hold the platforms until the Coruscant arrive, jump them out, and attack.
Same way we'd let the pursuing force catch up to you every so often to keep them believing they can eventually take you out, Jessica commented.
This is going to be fun.
The Seiki still has a working cloaking device, Nathan reminded them. They can keep an eye on our pursuers, possibly without being noticed.
That, too, will only work for so long,
the general pointed out. Unless they're stupid, Jessica said, which so far they seem to be.
The worst thing we could do at this point is to underestimate them, the general warned.
It was a joke, Jessica groaned. Sir.
I'll talk to Vlad about jumping the battle platforms as soon as possible, Nathan promised.
Keep me updated, the general said before ending the call.
God, Jacques have no sense of humor, Jessica said, rolling her eyes as she laid out on the couch. Wake me for breakfast, she said, closing her eyes.
Well, resurrection certainly hasn't changed you, has it?
Chapter 2.
You don't understand, Nathan, Vladimir insisted. These things are being held together with I don't know what. There is so much mismatched wiring in this thing it boggles the mind. On one emitter leg alone, and yes, they put multiple emitters on the same leg instead of an individual run for each emitter, there were 5 different types of power conduit. 5. Do you know what that does to the power levels on those emitters?
Then how the hell did they manage to jump? Nathan wondered.
Get this. They calculate the variances and estimate the time it takes to get each emitter up to the desired charge, and then they jump.
So it works?
Yes, it works, but if one little thing goes wrong, this thing will come apart and come out of the jump in 12 different locations.
Then they can jump.
Please give me a few more days, Nathan.
We don't have a few more days, Vlad. Besides, can you honestly tell me you can make things any better in a few days?
I couldn't fix this mess in a few months, Vladimir insisted. It needs to be stripped down and rebuilt from the ground up, and that's just the jump drive. Oh, and did I mention that they only have 1? There is no redundant.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.